Welcome to OPCC. Welcome to those of you joining online. We're glad you're here today. Happy Father's Day. Did everybody get a hat? Anybody not get a hat? Ladies raising their hand. You got t-shirts, Sharon. You got a t-shirt for Mother's Day. You can't have a hat too. No, I'm just kidding. Sharon, you can have this hat. Yes. Love Sharon. She's you can call her Johnny if you want. That's what she told me. I don't know why, but that's how I know her. It's good to see you all. If you are a father, what a great day. I think it's the joy of my life is to be a dad. I'm raising two boys and three girls, pretty much down to, you know, I don't think you ever quit, like, sort of raising them in some fashion or another or influencing them. But we're, you know, we only have two left in high school, so it's kind of fun to watch them in this different phase of life. Some of you here, you know, your dad's still living. You need to take advantage of that. My dad passed away when I was 40. He's been gone for 14 years now. And man, my dad was like my best friend, and I just miss him. Miss being able just to, just miss him. Like, I have dreams sometimes, and it feels like I went to see him, and those are good days. And some of you maybe didn't have a great relationship with your father growing up, and I get that, and it could be hard to hear somebody like me talking about how amazing my father was. And I would just say, man, you need to be the greatest father you can be. And there are many fathers, many spiritual fathers that we have in Christ. And so we need to celebrate that as well. And just thank the Lord for fatherhood. It's certainly a blessing to be a part of that experience as a man. And so today we're going to talk about man's man. It's Genesis chapter 38. It is a doozy, guys. I just want to say to you, if you brought your kids up here for this service, we have a kids' ministry, and you should have had them down there, and you can deal with all the questions that happen after we talk about this stuff today. But just know, I'm teaching from the Bible today, okay? But it's some wild stuff, so get ready. It's good stuff, and as we unpack it, I think it'll teach us a little bit about some things about how to follow the Lord, and really no other way to set this up but other than to jump in. So let's do it. Amen. Now, where we're at in the story is last week, Jacob's sons, he's got 12 sons, 11 of them are a little older, and Joseph is one they're very envious of. And so his 10 of his brothers let that envy get out of control, and they were going to kill him. One of them talked him out of doing that, and so they ended up throwing him in a pit. They take him out of a pit, and they sell him into slavery, thinking they'll never see him again. And so he's taken off to Egypt, and they won't see him for about 20 years, I think it is. And then they go back to their dad, make up this story. They take his coat, dip it in some animal's blood, and take it back to their father. And kind of the story is told that he's torn by a wild beast of some sort. So his dad thinks that Joseph is dead. 10 of the brothers know he's been sold. Now they're living with a family secret, and Joseph is carried off into Egypt. And God is going to use that and work in that. And sometimes it feels like everything's falling apart in our lives. We don't understand why. And it isn't until later that we can see it. And we'll see that play out in Joseph's life. But one of the brothers, Judah, it says that at that time, he left his brothers. So Joseph is carried off. The brothers are still with their father, Jacob, taking care of the family business. But it says at that time, Judah left his brothers and he went down to stay with a man of Adullam named Hira. And there Judah met the daughter of a Canaanite man named Shua. And he married her and made love to her. And she became pregnant and gave birth to a son who was named Ur. And she conceived again and gave birth to a son and named him Onan. And she gave birth to still another son and named him Shelah. And it was at Kazib that she gave birth to him. Judah, the father, got a wife for Ur, his firstborn, and her name was Tamar. But Ur, Judah's firstborn, was wicked in the Lord's sight. So the Lord put him to death. Okay? Aren't you glad you're living in the age of grace, man? This took him out. Well, what's going on here? Well, it is the age of the law. It's the age of judgment. It's the age of writing of the law and giving the law to humanity. You say, yeah, well, that's why I don't like the Old Testament. I like to learn about Jesus. Who do you think the God that took this guy out was? Jesus. Just Jesus hasn't manifested himself in the flesh yet. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, all the same. So don't buy into any of this garbage that says, well, the Old Testament is the one that I don't ascribe to the Old Testament. That's ridiculous. The Old Testament is what makes the New Testament so powerful because of all the prophecies of what it says that God will do. And so it's the same God that we're learning about in the Old Testament as in the New Testament. The New Testament is that we can finally understand the Old Testament. It makes sense, helps us to understand it. And so this guy is wicked, man. He's so wicked that in the age of the law, God would execute justice sometimes like this. And what age are we living in? We're living in the age of grace. So in the age of the law being written and given to the people, we see God functioning this way. Then Jesus comes, God in the flesh, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And he says he is the Word. So now Jesus is a human explanation of the law that is given. That's the age of revelation of the law and being manifested in Christ. Christ dies, rises from the dead, sends back the Holy Spirit. The church comes out of the ground, and now we're living in the age of grace. And so we are headed back to execution of judgment for all time during all of these periods about how people lived. And that is the return of Christ will happen, and then that will begin the timeline for that to take place. And so that's what's going on with why this guy is stricken down for his wickedness. And Judah said to Onan, son number two, middle child. No, he's got a problem out of the middle child, right? I was kind of in the middle. Then Judah said to Onan, sleep with your brother's wife and fulfill your duty to her as brother-in-law to raise up offspring for your brother. What is going on here? Well, there was no welfare system. There was no social security. If you were a widow, you were like, things could be bad for you. There was no one to take care of you. If you didn't have any sons, no one was going to take care of you. You're older, and so the way the system worked is that your sons received the inheritance of the father. And so if you had three sons, when he died, whatever he had went to each one of the sons, a third, a third, a third, and that son was responsible for taking care of his mother until she died and taking care of all of her expenses and everything when his father died. And so like when a widow that had no children took place, and Jesus was asked about this in the New Testament, and you can read about that. I don't have time to talk about it. But what would happen is if a woman became a widow and she didn't have any children, then there was a practice of what is called the duty of the brother-in-law. He would go into her and he would sleep with her until she conceived and had a son. And that son would receive that brother's portion of the inheritance. So he would take that portion. So if there's three brothers, it's a third, a third, a third. Even though he's not a brother to them, he takes the place of that brother. And so Onan was to go in and do that. This actually becomes a part of the law when the law is given to Moses, as this is how things were to function. And so Onan knew that the child would not be his. So whenever he slept with his brother's wife, he spilled his semen on the ground to keep from providing offspring for his brother. And what he did was wicked in the Lord's sight, so the Lord put him to death also. Happy Father's Day. You got a hat, so enjoy yourself. So what is this guy doing? He knows the kid is not going to be his, and he also knows that if there's not another child, it will be split 50-50, okay? And so He's thinking only of himself, and he's not fulfilling the duty of the brother-in-law. And so the Lord looks at that. God looks at that and executes judgment on it as wickedness. And so then Judah has lost two sons at this point to this woman he found to marry his first son. And so he says to his daughter-in-law, Tamar, live as a widow in your father's household until my son Shelah grows up. And so he's like, you go. He's got a younger son, like the youngest of the family, and he's like, we got to wait for him to get a little older, and when he gets a little older, I'll send for you. He has no intentions of doing that. It says, because it goes on, it says, go live in your father. For he thought he may die too, just like his brothers, so Tamar went to live in her father's household. He didn't want to send back for her. He's like, this woman's bad news, man. There's an omen going on here. My boys keep dying. I got to get her out of here. But I'm going to tell her this, and he sends her on his way. And so after a long time, it says, Judah's wife, the daughter of Shua, died. And when Judah had recovered from his grief, he went up to Timnah to the men who were shearing his sheep, and his friend Hira, the Adullamite, went with him. And so the guy that he met originally, like, is going with him. His wife has died. He's gone through the grieving process, which takes some time when you lose a spouse. Can't expect that you're just going to be all right immediately. And he's gone through this grieving process and recovered somewhat from it. And it's a real festive time when they go up to this sheep shearing. And so there would have been a lot of food, it's kind of a party atmosphere, if you will. It's the celebration, if you want. And they're celebrating that they're about to make some money, and so like they're excited, and they're this a festive time, and so he's on his way to join his guys. When Tamar, his daughter-in-law, who was still practicing the rites of the widow, which means she had to dress a certain way so that everybody knew she was a widow, which was hands off, when Tamar was told, your father-in-law is on his way to Timnah to shear his sheep, she took off her widow's clothes, covered herself with a veil to disguise herself, and then sat down at the entrance to Enaim, which is on the road to Timnah. For she saw that though Shelah had now grown up, she had not been given to him as his wife. She recognized, man, he's never calling for me. Like, he's just going to let me die in this state, and I've got a future to think about here. And when Judah saw her, he thought she was a prostitute because she dressed up that way. For she had covered her face, not realizing that she was his daughter-in-law. He went over to her by the roadside. Now, let's talk about prostitution here, because that's what you want to do every Sunday. So there were two types of prostitution. And one type was that a wife could prostitute herself out to another man and commit adultery on her husband, and she was referred to as a prostitute. Or a woman could just try to make money at prostitution, and she was looked down upon in society. But then there was the shrine prostitute. And the shrine prostitute was one in which she was not looked down upon in society. As a matter of fact, she was looked at as a religious person, as a shrine prostitute. It was good and encouraged in this pagan land to have sex with a shrine prostitute. There might have been a shrine prostitute that would help with the rain. There might have been a shrine prostitute that would help with a bumper harvest. And so it was encouraged. If you go in and you're making an offering, if you sleep with her. This is not a hard church to grow if you're pastoring that one, right? But that's the reality of what was going on. And so like it was in this culture that he was living in, that these people that were pagan, that's how they functioned and worshiped. And you say, boy, that is crazy. It's really not much crazier than some of the stuff that was going on in our lifetime, okay? Let me stay on track. So this is what she had dressed herself up as. She had sat on the road. She had disguised herself. She took off the widow's clothes. She put on the clothes of a shrine prostitute. And when Judah saw her, he goes up to her And he says to her, come now, let me sleep with you. And what will you give me to sleep with you? She asked. I'll send you a young goat for my flock, he said, which was a good deal. And will you give me something as a pledge until you send it? She asked. He said, well, what pledge should I give you? Your seal and its cord and the staff in your hand, she answered. So he gave them to her and slept with her, and she became pregnant by him. And after she left, she took off her veil and put on her widow's clothes again. Now, the three things that she gave to him, the signet ring or identifier with a cord around it, was what he would have used to mark any kind of seal. If he wanted to seal and send an official communication, roll it up, they'd put something, some wax on it, and he would press it. He would take it off his neck and press it with his seal. At any exchange of goods, it was sort of like that. That's his driver's license. That's his ID. And it had a cord around it that would have been particularly special to him that would have identified him as well. And then he had his staff. And all these shepherds had staffs, and they would sit around sometimes, I'm sure, and they would, that was a special thing they had, and they probably made carvings on it and things. And so she basically got three forms of ID to make sure he was going to pay up, right? That gets interesting. And so she leaves, and meanwhile, it says that Judah sent the goat by his friend the Adullamite in order to get his pledge back from the woman. But he did not find her. And he asked the men who lived there, where is the shrine prostitute who was beside the road at Enam? There hasn't been any shrine prostitute here, they said. So he went back to Judah and said, I didn't find her. Besides, the men who lived there said, there hasn't been any shrine prostitute here. Then Judah said, let her keep what she has, or we will become a laughingstock. After all, I did send her this young goat, but you didn't find her. About 3 months later, Judah was told, your daughter-in-law, Tamar, is guilty of prostitution. And as a result, she is now pregnant. Judah said, bring her out and have her burned to death. She's been the problem the whole time, and it's messed up thinking. As she was being brought out, she sent a message to her father-in-law. I am pregnant by the man who owns these, she said. And she added, see if you recognize whose seal and cord and staff these are. Judah recognized them and said, she is more righteous than I, since I wouldn't give her to my son, Shelah. And he did not sleep with her ever again. Okay, so he never goes into her again. And when he says she's more righteous than I, let's clear up something. That doesn't mean that what she did was righteous in the sight of God. What he's saying, when she's more righteous than I, he's looking at what has happened here, the sin of both of them, and he's saying, what I have done is worse than what she has done. And he's recognizing it, and he does not go in to sleep with her again. And when the time came for her to give birth, there were twin boys in her womb, and as she was giving birth, one of them put out his hand, so the midwife took a scarlet thread and tied it on his wrist and said, this one came out first. But when he drew back his hand, his brother came out and said, and she said, so this is how you have broken out. And he was named Perez, which means breaking out. Then his brother, who had the scarlet thread on his wrist, came out, and he was named Zerah. Now, I know what you're thinking. Boy, I want to see you draw some application for my life from that one today, Jimmy. All right? And I was thinking the same thing when I read this. I was like, Lord, what in the heck did you put this in here? But there's a reason for it. And again, one of the things we can see from this is chapter 38 is this is proof, again, that the Bible is divinely inspired. What human being in your right mind do you know that wants to get people to believe something, to follow it, to lay down their lives and be willing to die for it and to give financially to it and say, this is what you need to believe, folks, puts chapter 38 in there. You don't put that chapter in there if you're writing it on your own. That's how we can look at it and go, this is divinely inspired, because humans, like, could you imagine us as a religious group of people in Overland Park saying, hey, we're going to put out a book about our members and all the great things that our members have accomplished, and let's be sure to include in a chapter in there someone who has been guilty of the sin of adultery and a pedophile, and just put all the bad stuff in there. We wouldn't do that. Why? Because we want to reflect a good reflection of our church, right? So like, these guys, men, this is incest that is happening in this family, and it is written here, and it's like head scratching. And go, well, what are we supposed to take away from it? Well, I'm going to give you, there are several actions that Judah takes, and there are four that we need to avoid like the plague, okay? Because we look at this and go, okay, here's the reality, is there's a lot of things that Judah did that are happening in the American church today. As a matter of fact, I'm confident, I don't know, but I just know that the church is big enough now that some of you walked in here today and you're doing the very same kind of actions that Judah did. Now, you may not be doing the same sins, but the same steps that lead you to a place of sin that got him where he was at. So there are four things I'm going to give you that you need to avoid like the plague. You need to be aware of them. You need to be paying attention to what's going on in your family. You need to be paying attention to what's going on inside of you that is influencing your family this way. And then there's one thing that we ought to grab a hold of and never forget and like make it a normal practice of our lives. And we will be better men and women for it. And so the first thing that we notice that he did, Judas developed a foolish friendship. What does he do? The Bible says that after this, after what? After they sold Joseph into slavery, he left his brothers and went down to this foreign land and made this friendship with a guy, an Adullamite by the name of Hira. Okay? And so, why do you think he did that? I think that he goes down there because I think he can't deal with the shame he feels about hiding what they have done to Joseph, his father's son, and they're hiding it from his dad. He can't live with it. He's got to get out of there, man. I can't live amidst the lie, so he runs. We see this happening in people all the time. They get involved in sin, and their sin makes them feel guilty, and so they don't know what to do with it, and they just run away from it. Instead of going and making it right and trying to have the courage that you need to do what needs to be done, just leave your brothers and go find you some new friends to do life with, okay? I believe probably this Hira guy was probably a very cool dude. Not a nerd. Probably very well connected and a whole lot of fun because he needed to forget about a lot of pain. He probably knew who to hang out with, where all the cool spots were. And here is Judah in this place. Man, he's trying to get away, get a restart. And he runs into this guy by the name of Hira. And he leaves his brothers and makes this friendship with this guy. And that's foolish. And some of you are doing that very thing today. Some of you have more friends than you do brothers and sisters in Christ. You have more foolish friendships, and you spend more time with people who do not care anything about the Word of God, living their lives in a way that honors God, and that is a foolish relationship. Now, should you have relationships like that? Absolutely. The gospel cannot travel from person to person unless you have some relationships with some unbelievers. So the problem isn't that you have relationships with unbelievers. The problem is you don't have any relationships with your brothers and sisters. And you have more relationships with unbelievers than you do people who are trying to follow the Lord as their Savior and reflect and honor him in their daily lives. And so what happens is if you get more unbelieving friends in your life than you have believing friends, it starts to put you in a place that where you make the second action that he did. Maybe not specifically what he did, but Judah married an unbelieving wife. Why? It's not surprising because he was running with unbelievers. How are you going to meet a believing wife if you're spending all your time with unbelievers? You see, you surround yourself with unbelievers, and then your decisions tend to be rooted in unbelief. That's what happened to me when I was younger. I love the Lord, man. At 9 years old, I met the Lord and loved the Lord. But at a point in my life, I started moving away from how the scale was tilted in the favor of being more of my relationships with believers than there were unbelievers. It sort of shifted, and now there are more unbelievers. There were fun, good people. We're not talking about people that are like, oh, this guy is so just a bad person. He's bad. No, they're good people. They just don't believe. They're unbelievers. And I developed relationships with them. And if you get too many of them, more than you do believing people in your life, then the peer pressure is elevated. It becomes stronger and your desire to please the Lord becomes weaker. And it's not very long before you're making a foolish decision and you're spending time with more and more people and doing more and more things that will bring greater harm to your life. That's exactly what happened to me, and you see it happening in people's lives. There's some of you, man, you're like, I keep doing the same stupid stuff, and I can't figure out why I keep doing the same stuff. This pattern is repeated in my life. How come I can't overcome this, God? And he's saying, because you've got too many knuckleheads in your life. That's the reality. You just can't. It's your flesh is too weak. That's why Jesus said, I'm going to build a church, a group of people, a gathering of believers that the gates of hell can't stop. As a matter of fact, they will start showing up in places where the hell has to retreat. And so we say, how do I know if I've got a person that's a believer in my life that's a good, healthy relationship? Well, does hell retreat or increase when they come over? That's all you got to do. He said, well, I know exactly. I know when I'm around them, I can look at the way I act and the things that I do, and you can begin to see, man, they're not having a good impact on my life. Again, we're not saying they're bad people, and we're not saying we shouldn't have any relationships like that. But what we are saying is it's foolish to get there because you end up in this place where your decisions get rooted in unbelief. And for him, he takes a wife who is an unbeliever, which you should never do. You should never do that. You say, why? Because they don't believe like you. And that's just a recipe for disaster. Now, some of you have already done that. What do you do? Well, we're going to pray and hope that that person is won over by your faith and they see God moving in your life. So it's not grounds for you to terminate the relationship by any means. You're going to live out your faithfulness. You've already made the decision. But it is a reason that if you're younger or you're single and you start dating this girl that's like, and she tells you she doesn't know Jesus, cut that thing off, man. The greatest, like Abby, I thought Abby was the most beautiful girl I'd ever laid eyes on. If she would have told me that she didn't know the Lord, or I would have sensed in her she wasn't serious about following the Lord, it's over. I don't want to spend my life with you. Why? Because I know what Jesus has done in my life, and I know you're just going to pull me away from that if you're not serious about it. And so, like, that's like you young people who are dating. You're dating some knucklehead that doesn't care for the Lord, or you're dating some girl that doesn't care for the Lord. I can guarantee you are going to sacrifice your purity. You're going to sacrifice things that you don't want to compromise on, and you're going to end up in the same place as Judah. You may not get married, but you're going to end up in a place of pain. This guy has pain written all over his life. He had two children that he was producing offspring that didn't care anything about the things of God because their mother didn't know anything about the things of God, and their father wasn't sharing. He was living like an unbeliever in this time in their lives, and it was consequential for him. And so we see it play out. What happens? He becomes unfaithful in his commitments. He sent Tamar away. She was believing in time he was going to send back for her. He had no intention of doing that. He knew he was not going to do that. As a matter of fact, he had come to a place in his life where he thought she was the problem. He had been given over to a reprobate mind. He had become depraved in his thinking. He wasn't functioning out of a place of belief. He was functioning from a place of unbelief because of who he had chosen to spend his time around, and he had not balanced the scales in a wise place, had more people in his life who feared God than he did people who didn't fear God. So before long, he quit fearing God, and he started thinking crazy things like, she's the one responsible for my two sons being dead.
Let's send her out of here. He said, well, could it really get that bad in a culture? We got people trying to say, you can't tell if a man is a man and a woman is a woman. That's insane. Like, and somebody said, well, I can't believe he said that. I can't believe you think that. I don't care what you, I'm not, you, like you can't, you can be in your insanity you want and you can invite me, but no thanks. Like, I don't want to be there because I know the freedom that I have in Christ. And I don't care what you do to me, and I don't care if you don't like me anymore, because I'm going to do what you need to see is truth. I'm not going to come and like throw rocks at you, but I am going to say it's enough. You're not going to tell me how I'm going to think, because I'm going to rely on the word, because I look at humanity, and the more humanity is left to itself, the more ridiculous it gets, okay? And so, like, I believe I'm created in the image of God, and I'm going to walk that out in my life, and I'm going to be faithful in my commitments. This guy, he's tilting things all in the wrong way, and what we see eventually happens, Judah was not only in Canaan, but Canaan was in him. And that's what happens, is that the world starts to get inside the believer. This is one of the, he's one of the sons that would be the patriarch of one of the 12 tribes of Israel that would become the nation, the people who would receive the law from God, and more importantly, in that law and through all those prophecies over thousands of years would come the Messiah. And he's compromising. And it's costing him dearly. And so he didn't even bat an eye when it came to sleeping with the prostitute. How in the world did that happen? How in the world did he get to a place where he knew? I mean, we're talking about, man, this guy's dad was Jacob. Jacob wrestled with Jesus in the flesh, like Jesus manifested himself in flesh and Jacob wrestled with him. That's his dad. How did he get here? I'll tell you exactly how he got here. He went through the grieving process after his wife had died, and he had a buddy that was a whole lot of fun that didn't care anything about the things of God, and it wasn't really his fault because he didn't know anything about the things of God, and his buddy here, Judah, wasn't teaching him anything because Judah left his brothers, went down to him, and now Hira is a fun dude. And they're like walking into town. He's like, it's going to be great, man. I'm so glad you're finally getting out. You're over your grieving of your wife. We're going to have a good time, man. There's going to be a party there. It's going to be festive, and I can't hardly wait to get there. We're going to have fun, Judah. We're going to have fun. And they're walking down the road, and they're talking. He's picking Judah up in his spirits, man. And as they're walking, there's the shrine prostitute on the road. And he's like, whoa, it's your lucky day, bro. And he doesn't know there's anything wrong with this. This is the way he was raised. You can't fault this guy. And so I don't fault people for believing a lie that have been brought up in a lie. I just don't want you to try to expect me to start believing the lie. I'm going to try to help you correct you. And that's not what Judah did. Man, the guy's like, man, this is your lucky day, man, your lucky day. And but who knows what might happen if you go and make an offering to that shrine prostitute. And so the next thing you know, and we don't know all that happened. The Bible doesn't say that, but it does say he was with him. And it would be insane to think that that's not what would happen. That's just what guys do often. And so here they are, man. He goes up to her and he compromises. It was normal for the Canaanites, and so he succumbed to the temptation. And that's the consequence of compromise is one sin leads to another sin, and usually most of them are found out, and sometimes very publicly. So those are four actions of Judas that we want to avoid like the plague. The one thing that we want to do that he did was repent. That's the one thing he did. He said, well, I didn't see repentance in this whole thing. When his sins found him out, the first thing that he does is confess that what he did was awful. What she has done, she is more righteous than I. Like, this is awful. And he has a change because he doesn't go in and sleep with her again. Never again does he sleep with her. Now, a lot of guys would have looked at that and said, well, one, we could just still get rid of her. Nobody will know. Just send her off. Say she's making this whole thing up. Two, he could have said, well, the deal's been done. He probably was attracted to her because he's the one who found her for his first son, Ur. So he probably already, in some way or shape or form, he was attracted to her. Not in a weird way when he found her for his son, but you know, like that's probably what happened. This would be a good wife for my son. And now he could have said, well, she's younger than me. I mean, it works out good for me. And the Canaanites don't care. They don't care how I live. What difference does it make to them? But he doesn't do that. He doesn't go back in to sleep with her again. He doesn't try to hide it. He owns it. And I believe he genuinely repented. What does repentance mean? It means to change your mind. It means to change the way you're thinking. Repent before the Lord. Believe in Christ and repent is what the Bible calls us to do. And so when we repent, we change the way we're thinking about something. And that's exactly what he did. How do we know he did that? Well, if you flip over to chapter 49 of the same book, Genesis chapter 49, this is a very important passage that reveals a lot to us as we walk through the book of Genesis. Chapter 49 is where Jacob blesses all of the kids. There are prophetic utterances in the blessing. Like, so there's something prophetic that ends up playing out in this son's family line over the years. And so, and it also speaks that as to how and who will, you know, how they will prosper. And so we start with, as Jacob reveals the blessing, I'm not going to read them, but Reuben is first. Remember, Reuben was the son who went in and defiled his father's marriage bed. And so he screwed up royalty, and it's not a good blessing that falls on his life. And the second two are Simeon and Levi. Same thing. Remember, they are the two who went into Shechem, and they slaughtered all of those people to get revenge for what those people, what that one guy had done to their sister, Dinah. Okay? So that's the second two. It's bad, the blessing on them. Like, let nobody enter their council. Let me not join their assembly. These are the words. Then we get to Judah. You say, oh, it's going to be bad. Judah is going to be a mess. If those guys were, well, what? Listen to what it says about Judah. Now, he's gone back to his brothers. You say, how do you know he went back to his brothers? Because he's getting a blessing. So he has left the foreign land that he was in, and he's taken his family back home. Judah, your brothers will praise you. Your hand will be on the neck of your enemies. Your father's sons will bow down to you. You are a lion's cub, Judah. You return from the prey, my son. Like a lion, he crouches and lies down. Like a lioness, who dares to rouse him? The scepter will not depart from Judah, not the ruler's staff, nor the ruler's staff from between his feet, until he to whom it belongs shall come, and the obedience of the nations shall be his. He will tether his donkey to a vine, his colt to the choicest branch. He will wash his garments in wine, his robes in the blood of grapes. His eyes will be darker than wine, his teeth whiter than milk. That's a good blessing. Like, that is some promising stuff that happens to this guy who was so steeped in sin for a period in his life. How? I believe he repented. He repented and he went back home. Now, the big idea is this. It's not about goodness. It's not about badness. It's about salvation. If you believe that, man, I'm good enough, like I'm going to make it in. I'm living a good life. I'm a pretty good moral person. And there are a lot of incredibly moral people in the world. But if you think that, you are lost and on your way to hell. If you think that you're so bad that you can't get to heaven, you are lost and on your way to hell. Both good people and bad people go to hell. It has nothing to do with goodness or badness. And we can see it in this picture of this guy. And I'm going to put this all together for you here in a moment. What it has to do with is, do you know Jesus? Do you know what he did, who he is? Do you recognize him as God in the flesh who died for your sins? And it has nothing to do with goodness or badness. You're not good. Oh, I'm going to be good and show Jesus how good I can be. You're not good. You're fallen just like this guy. You're capable of doing everything this guy has done. And probably most of the sins, maybe not exactly the same things that got him there, you have probably committed. Foolish friendships, foolish decisions, letting the world get too much in you. Now, here's the most unlikely, encouraging verse in Scripture. It's one of those verses you're reading along and you're just like, okay, I'm going to skip this. I don't have time. I got to be at work, man. I'm just like, I don't need to read this, right? And so-and-so begat so-and-so. And so-and-so begat so-and-so. How many of you skipped that section? It's okay to tell the truth. One person raised their hand. Oh, okay. Here's his. I usually skip them too, though. Matthew chapter 1. Ancestry.com for Jesus. This is the genealogy of Jesus, the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac. Isaac, the father of Jacob. Jacob, the father of Judah and his brothers. Not Joseph. Joseph is going to live an incredible life. It's Judah. Judah, the father of Perez and Zerah, the two twins whose mother was Tamar. What the heck is going on? She's a Gentile. She's way down there in Jesus' family line. What is this, a mistake? No, this is exactly what God wants us to see, is that the gospel would be open to the Gentiles, and the Gentiles would even participate in the coming of the Messiah, as Jesus is showing us, and God is showing us that from the sinful flesh, he descended. And so just like you struggle with sin, the writer of Hebrews says that Jesus struggled with sin. This is what he says in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14. Since the children have flesh and blood, he too shared in their humanity so that by his death he might break the power of him who holds the power of death, that is the devil, and free those who all their lives were held in slavery by their fear of death. For surely it is not angels he helps, but Abraham's descendants. For this reason, he had to be made like them, fully human in every way, in order that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in service to God, and that he might make atonement for the sins of the people. Because he himself suffered when he was tempted, he is able to help those who are being tempted. This is called, in theology, the hypostatic union of deity and humanity. What does that mean? It means that Jesus was born of earthly flesh. And we can look even in his genealogy and go, man, that's not one I want. You might want to say, hey, my ancestor way down the road was Abraham Lincoln, right? But you don't want to say, my ancestor way down the road, man, he committed incest and these two kids were born. And God is saying, I came from that. I came into that mess. But I didn't have an earthly father because it was a virgin birth and the seed was holy and it came into that womb and the flesh was born and he came and dwelt among us. And so everything that was in Jesus was man and God. He wasn't man's man. He was God's man. He was the God man. Like he was God in the flesh. And so like we look at that, we go, oh my gosh, why is this there? Martin Luther said in chapter 38 of Genesis that is there to rebuke pride. When you think, oh, I'm pretty good. You're not. Even the, like we look in Jesus' family, there's no, not one is good. All are desperately wicked and fall short of the glory of God. There's no such thing as goodness when it comes to the holy standard of God. And then it's also to challenge despair.
I'm not worthy. No, you're not, he's saying. But I am, and I've come to help you in your unworthiness. I've come to help the descendants of Abraham. Would you take my hand and let me be your Lord and Savior? This is the gospel.